It's the gospel truth. It's the word of the Lord, inspired by the Holy Spirit. It's a two-edged sword. It's a roadmap to heaven, and it's heaven's good news. Thank God for the Bible. It's the gospel truth.
It's time for the Gospel Truth with Dr. Scott Thomas of Temple, Georgia. For more information about the ministry and the music of Brother Scott, go each week to www.scottthomasministries.com. That's www.scottthomasministries.com. You can get more messages and music at the website, so be sure to go to www.scottthomasministries.com once every week. And now, here is Dr. Scott Thomas and the Gospel Truth.
When I'm hungry, feet sweet, man. Hebrews chapter number 3 this morning, verse 7. Verse 7 through 19. And once you find the place, Hebrews chapter number 3, verse 7 through 19. Just a few of you found the place. Find the place, stand. There's more, there you go. Amen. Hebrews 3, 7 through 19. Preach this morning kind of a message. Most people just don't get it. Most people just don't get it. Hebrews chapter 3, verse 7 says, "Wherefore, as the Holy Ghost saith, today if ye will hear his voice, harden not your hearts as in the provocation, in the day of temptation in the wilderness, when your fathers tempted me, proved me, and saw my works 40 years. Wherefore I was grieved with that generation, and said, They do alway err in their heart, and they have not known my ways. So I swear in my wrath, they shall not enter into my rest." They just didn't get it. "Take heed, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. But exhort one another daily while it is called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. For we are made partakers of Christ if we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast unto the end. While it is said, Today if ye will hear his voice, harden not your hearts as in the provocation. For some, when they had heard, did provoke. Howbeit, not all that came out of Egypt by Moses. But with whom was he grieved 40 years? Was it not with them that had sinned, whose carcasses fell in the wilderness? And to whom sware he that they should not enter into his rest, but to them that believed not? So we see that they could not enter in because of unbelief." You can be seated this morning. Most people just don't get it. Most people just don't get it. I recall a little funny story I heard. My sister-in-law is a teacher, and she had a student, my understanding, who was from a Latino family, and so she spoke Spanish. The little girl could actually speak English, but she acted like she could not speak English. And my sister-in-law kept trying to get her to speak English and teach her more English and so forth. And finally, I think the way the story goes, if I got it right, the little girl finally looked at her and said, "You stupid, you just don't get it." And that's why some folks are. They just don't get it. And some people just don't get it, and some people just don't want to get it. And here in the Word of God, from our text, we see that there were some of these old Israelites that came out of Egypt, went through that wilderness for 40 years, never did go to the promised land because they just did not get it. They did not get the promised land, and they did not get the Lord and what He was doing. We see in our text in verse 8, it mentions it. "Harden not your hearts as in the provocation." And verse 15, he said, "Harden not your hearts as in the provocation." What is this provocation thing? Well, that provocation means they provoked God. It actually explains it in verse 16. "For some, when they had heard, did provoke. Howbeit not all that came out of Egypt by Moses, there were some that were provoking God because of what? Their unbelief. And unbelief will keep you from getting it. Amen? What is the it that folks don't get? What is it that most people are not getting? Well, most people don't get honest. Amen? Most people just don't get honest. They never get straightforward about their sins. And they never get sincere about their salvation. It is up to every man to work out his own salvation. Every woman, every boy, every child, everybody that's under conviction, everyone that has reached the age of accountability, it is up to them to work out their own salvation. And most do not get honest enough to work out their own salvation. They never get straightforward about their sins. They never get sincere about their salvation. And if you never get straightforward and admit you are a sinner, along with being sincere and accepting the Savior, you just won't get it. You just will not get right with God until you get honest with God. And if you keep lying to yourself and keep lying to others and to God that you and the Lord are okay and we're just right and everything's hunky-dory and everything's just fine, you will not get salvation and you will not get to go to heaven. That's just the simple fact of the matter. You first got to be honest before God and say, I'm a sinner. I'm lost. I need salvation. And that's the only way you'll get it. But most people don't get it. Most people don't get honest. Most people don't get humble. Amen? They are never sorry. They're never regretful. They're never remorseful. They're never repentant. And friend, therefore, they do not get it. Most people, they're not shamefaced. Some are so blind that they cannot even see. They should be ashamed of their lifestyle. Be ashamed of their lives. Be ashamed of their loves. And be ashamed of their loving. And be ashamed of their looks. Amen. Listen here. Some people are in love with the world and they don't even realize they ought to be ashamed for loving the world more than loving Christ. Their lifestyles, their lives, their looks, their loving. I mean, they just live like the world and they're not even shamefaced about it. They just don't get it. They're never sorry. They're never shamefaced. They are never submissive. They just don't get it. They are never submissive to the Lord's preaching or to the Lord's power. Therefore, they just don't get it. But friend, I'm telling you, this is a serious thing. And I'm telling you right now, there's a thing you don't want to miss, and that's heaven. And the only way you can get to heaven is through salvation. And if you don't get humble and if you don't get honest, you just won't get it. They are never submissive. They don't get it. They are never sheepish. What do you mean by that? Well, some are never humble and become God's sheep. Some are never humble and become God's servants. Friend, I want to be sheepish. I want to be one of God's sheep. Amen. And I want to follow Him. And I want to do what He has me to do. And I want to be right in line with what He wants for me. Otherwise, I may just not get all that He has for me. And you won't have all that He has for you if you don't get sheepish and submissive before the Lord. Some people just don't get honest. Most people don't get honest. Most people don't get humble. Most people just don't get holy. Amen? You'll have to get saved in order to get holy. If you get saved by the grace of God, you can be holy. Amen? Amen. You have to get Spirit-filled in order to get holy. You have to get sanctified to get holy. And friends, most people just don't get it. Why? But not because there's something wrong with them. Other than the fact that they do reject it and turn it away and do not desire it. I still believe if we'll draw nigh unto the Lord, He'll draw nigh unto us. And if the closer we get to God and more in His Word we get, and the closer to God we get, the more He'll move in and the more holy we can be. Now, friend, but most people just don't get it. Most people don't get us. Most people just don't get humble. Most people just don't get holy. And friend, that is a sad commentary today, but that is the truth of the matter. Hell has enlarged itself, and most people are going to hell. But I don't know about you. I don't want to be like most people. I want to get it today. And I want you to get it today. And you can get it today. If that sounds strange to you about being saved and Spirit-filled and sanctified, then you just don't get it. But you can get it today if you'll only desire and want it. See, the "it" that I'm referring to is what the Lord has for you and what the Lord wants for you. There are some old Israelites that we read about here in Hebrews 3 that never got what the Lord had for them. He had a whole promised land for them. He had everything worked out for them, and He wanted it for them because they were His children, and He wanted them to have what He had for them. But they just didn't get it because they didn't do certain things. And I'm going to preach to you just like if you was one of those old Israelites. Amen. That just didn't get it. Can I do that this morning? Hopefully, you will listen. Hopefully, you won't turn a deaf ear. Hopefully, you won't walk out of here murmuring like they did. You remember what Brother Bagel said they do? He said, murmur, 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 murmur. Remember that? Last revival? Boy, some people, that's why they leave church. It's murmur, 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 murmur. Just like no Israelites. And you can go off murmuring, and you'll go off murmuring right off into hell and never get it. But friend, today you can have it today. There's three problems as to why you cannot get it. The "it," like I said, is what the Lord has for you and what God wants for you. First of all, you can't acknowledge it, so you won't get it. Now those "it's" are two different things. You won't acknowledge it, so you won't get it. The Israelites couldn't acknowledge their past. Can you acknowledge your past? Friend, let me ask you. The Israelites, they just couldn't acknowledge their past. What do you mean? Well, they didn't acknowledge their suffering. They did not acknowledge their suffering. In Numbers chapter 14, 3 and 4, it said here, this is what they said, "Were it not better for us to return into Egypt?" Now down in Egypt they were slaves. Down in Egypt they were suffering. And they got out here, the Lord led them out from that horrible place and was taking them to the promised land. And they got out there in the wilderness and said, "My goodness, we're going to die." Sure as the world, unbelieving in Christ, unbelieving in God, brother. And friend, let me tell you something. They got out there and said, "We'd be better off if we just went back to Egypt." That was their attitude. And they said one to another, "Let us make a captain and let us return into Egypt. Let's forget about Moses. Let's forget about God's man. Let's don't listen to him. They don't let he said the Lord's leading him and going to lead us into the promised land. We just don't believe that. Let's get us a captain. Let's get us somebody. Raise them up and let's go back to Egypt. We're better off in Egypt than this." Unbelief. They could not acknowledge the truth that in Egypt they suffered. In Egypt they were slaves that suffered. In Egypt they were scum that suffered. Amen. People looked at them, the Egyptians looked at them as scum, looked at them as slaves and made them scum, and just there was nothing in the eyes of Egypt. The truth is, if they went back, the Egyptians would probably kill them for escaping. And if they hadn't done that, they just went right back into slavery and being treated like scum. Friend, I'm telling you this morning, if you're going to get what God has for you and get it, then you've got to acknowledge it, and you've got to acknowledge the past. If you're going to get what God has for you, then you've got to acknowledge that where you have been. and where you come from and how you've been living is making you a slave and is making you a scumbag. Amen. You will suffer when you're living in ungodliness. Friend, I'm telling you that now. It's just like an old sinner. You've got to realize that when you live in Egypt and you live in sorrow, you live in sin, and you live in that suffering and as a slave to Satan, friend, that you are nothing to him, that you are a scumbag, and he'll make you a scumbag, and he'll make you a slave. Friend, you've got to acknowledge that past and acknowledge the things you've done wrong in your past and say, Lord, forgive me, and Lord, deliver me from it, and Lord, I'm trusting you with it. If you don't acknowledge your past, you will not They didn't acknowledge their suffering, and they didn't acknowledge their sins. Their doubts were sinful. Every time they said, I just don't know about this, Moses. And I don't believe this, Moses. And I don't believe that God is with us. And every time they doubt, it was sinful. Their desires were sinful. Their desires were sinful. When they desired going back to Egypt, it was sinful. Their disobedience was sinful. You'll not get it until you acknowledge your sinful doubts, your sinful desires, and your sinful disobedience before the Lord. If you want what God wants for you, then you've got to get in this altar and call on God and say, Lord, I've doubted you, and I've desired the wrong things, and I've disobeyed you, and I've done wrong. I'm telling you right now, most people don't get that, but I'm here to tell you this morning, you can get it if you'll just do what I'm telling you this way. The Israelites couldn't acknowledge their past. The Israelites couldn't acknowledge the promise. The promises. God promised them this place called Canaan, but they would not acknowledge the promise, and therefore they did not claim the promised land. They was too many wandering around in the wilderness thinking about Egypt and thinking how in the world and murmuring among themselves. They never claimed the promised land, and therefore they didn't get it. Friend, you've got to acknowledge the promises. Oh, but there were some that said, hey, God promised this. And God said he would deliver us. And God, I believe God, and I'm trusting God. And it may look bad right now, but I'm still going to trust the Lord with all my heart. The Israelites could not acknowledge the promise, and they did not claim the promised land. And then those old Israelites, I'm talking about the old ones, not all of them, but the old ones, they did not conquer the promised land. God had promised a place to them, but they did not conquer it. And listen, God promised you a place where you can live in peace here on earth and in eternity. But you have to acknowledge that promise in order to get it. What I'm trying to tell you this morning, the Lord wants to save you if you're lost. And if you're not living where you ought to be living, and you haven't been faithful, and you haven't been trusting the Lord, and you're not where you ought to be with the Lord, you can. And you can get things right with God if you'll acknowledge the promise that God said, draw nigh unto me, and I'll draw nigh unto you. So many walk around aimlessly in circles, just like the old Israelites did, in defeat for years. Some of you, you've got to have been saved years ago. How about somewhere along the line you got off track? You're not where you ought to be with the Lord, and you've just wandered aimlessly in life. And just wandered around in the wilderness of life and feeling so defeated and feeling like you're nothing and all those things. But I'm here to tell you, the Lord wants to bring you out of that. And the Lord wants to put you in a good place in life. And the Lord wants to do something in your heart. But you've got to be honest with God. And you've got to be humble before God. And then God will make you holy. And God will put you in that place where you can live for God. Amen. Amen.
all the time. Oh, you don't have to acknowledge the promises of God and acknowledge the past. And then the Israelites couldn't acknowledge the power of God. You see, God had power to do things in their lives and did do some things. But then they refused to acknowledge the Lord's power. You say, what did he do for them? God had the power to slaughter the foes, the enemy. What about all those Israelites? I mean, those Egyptians. Pharaoh and all his army that was chasing them through the Red Sea. What about the fact that God parted the Red Sea for them to cross over? And once they crossed over, Pharaoh and his army went running in there, and God just shut it all down and drowned them all out.
Amen.
Friend, I tell you, God did that in their lives. And he did that for them. But yet, they get out in the wilderness. And every time they said, we might as well just go back to Egypt. You know what they're doing? They're denying the power of God. How many times has God done something in your life? Something amazing, something miraculous, something that you just knew it had to be God. And then just a few years later, a few short years later, a problem rises up and says, what in the world are we going to do? I might as well just forget all this. Friend, I tell you, just like those old Israelites, but God had the power to slaughter their foes. And God had the power to supply the food. What about when they're out there and didn't have nothing to eat? What did God do? He sent down manna. And he fed them again and again and again. Friend, I tell you, but they denied that, did they not?
Amen.
Every time they said, let's just go back to Egypt. We can't get in that promised land. There ain't no way. There's giants over there. There ain't no way we can make that. God can slaughter the sinful foes in your life. I want you to know that. And God can supply the spiritual food in your life. Amen. If you'll just acknowledge the past, if you'll just acknowledge the promises, and acknowledge the power of God, you can get what God has for you.
Amen.
But most people just don't get it. Because they never acknowledge the past, acknowledge the promises, acknowledge the power of God. You can't acknowledge it, so you won't get it. Number two, you can't accept it, so you won't get it. You've got to accept it. Somebody say amen right there.
Amen.
They didn't always accept God's perfection. How many know the Lord's perfect? Say amen.
Amen.
He's perfect. And we've got to accept that he's perfect.
Yeah.
But they didn't always accept God's perfection. What do you mean? They didn't always accept God's perfect wisdom. God had perfect. God knew what he was doing. God knew exactly how to get them out of the wilderness and take them to the promised land. But every time they doubted, every time they disobeyed, every time their desires went back to Egypt, the Lord said, fine, you don't believe in me? Just wander around just a little bit more. Just walk in circles just a little bit more. You don't want to put your faith in me, then go ahead, have your own way about it. You'll just stay out there in the wilderness and you'll die there, as far as I'm concerned. And that's what God did. You say, that's mean. That's mean-spirited. Don't take it up with me. Take it up with God. That's what he did. Amen. And friend, I tell you, unbelief will keep you from getting it.
Amen.
Unbelief will keep you from getting what God has for you. The one thing God wants you to do is just believe in him. And if you don't do that, you won't get it. You won't get what God has for you. They did not always accept God's perfect wisdom. And they did not always accept God's perfect wishes. You know what we ought to do every time the Lord tells us to do something? Just do it. Amen. It'd save us a whole lot of trouble. It'd save the Israelites a whole lot of trouble if they just and believed and trusted the Lord. When we do not heed to God's perfect wisdom and wishes, that's when we end up suffering. That's when we end up paying the consequences. They didn't always accept God's perfection, therefore they didn't get it. They didn't always accept God's plan, therefore they didn't get it. Therefore it caused them to keep wandering. Therefore it kept them to keep waiting. Amen. Listen, I realize sometimes the Lord has us, He puts us in the waiting room sometimes. We'll pray about something and God says, not that. And we have to wait on the Lord. But friend, let me tell you something. Sometimes the Lord gets blamed for a lot of things that we do. Amen. It's not always God that's putting us in the waiting room. Sometimes it's our unbelief that puts us in the waiting room. That makes sense. Listen, the Israelites kept wandering around in the wilderness and kept on waiting to die. We're just going to die out here. That's what they said. Well, Moses just brought us out here to die. That's unbelief. The Lord said, all right, you'll die there then. That's what you want to believe. That's what will happen. Amen. God made sure that they did die. Amen. In the wilderness. Amen. Because they did not accept His plan for them. Did you know God has a plan for every one of you here? Amen. And that plan, first of all, starts with salvation.
Amen.
Being born again, washed in the blood. And then from there, God has a plan for you to be in church. God has a plan to do wonderful things in your life and to help you and to bless you again and again and again. Will you accept it? They did. That's why they didn't get it. So many people today are just wandering around and aimlessly waiting to die just because they have not put their trust in God's plan. Then do it. They didn't always accept God's perfection, God's plan. They didn't always accept God's presence. At one point, the Israelites tried to go into the promised land only depending upon their own power. One day, they just got, I don't know, they got the courage or whatever. They said, hey, we can go in there. But God wouldn't with them. And if God ain't with you, you won't make it. They just didn't get it. They needed God.
Amen.
And friend, you need God.
Amen.
They didn't always accept God's presence. That was an act of rejecting God's presence. When you try to do things on your own without the Lord, that is an act of rejecting God's presence. You see, some people come along and they get the do betters. I'm going to do better. I'm going to start going to church. And I'm going to start reading that Bible. And I'm going to do this and I'm going to do that. And boy, they've got big plans to do better. But they skip a very important step. They didn't repent. They didn't call on God and ask for His help.
Amen.
And they didn't acknowledge His presence and say, Lord, I need You in order to do this. I've got to have You. And therefore, if you don't acknowledge God's presence, you just won't get it. And what happens? Pretty soon life happens. Pretty soon you're not reading like you thought you would. You're not going to church like you thought you were going to. That new leaf turned over and then it turned over again and again and again. And just blew away with you with it. Amen. And friend, let me tell you something. When that happens, that means you have not acknowledged God's presence and depended upon God's presence in your life. So many individuals and even churches as a whole are trying to do things without God's presence.
Amen.
And it just won't work. Let me tell you something. We come in here and we can have momentum and be motivated and I could give you a big pep rally talk and motivate you and be a motivational speaker that gets you all pepped up and riled up. And boy, we're going to have church. God's going to do something around here. And man, next thing you know, it just falls flat.
Amen.
Why?
Amen.
Because you never trust in God.
Right.
See, God does things that we can't do. And we've got to trust Him. So many are not dependent upon God's strength. That's churches and individuals.
Amen.
So many are not dependent upon God's steps, doing things God's way. That's churches and individuals. So many are not dependent on God's Son and God's salvation. If you'd only accept God's perfection and God's plan and God's presence in your life, you can get what God has for you. Most people just don't get it. Amen? Number three, and I'm done. You can't acquire it, so you won't get it. You can't acquire it on your own, is what I'm trying to tell you. So many want to acquire the blessings of God without meeting the requirements God expects. I want that blessing. I want God to bless me. Well, we all do. But what are we doing to get it? What I'm telling you, you can't acquire it on your own. You can't acquire God's blessings without meeting God's requirements.
Amen.
Hebrews 3:17. Look at it with me again, our text. But with whom was he grieved 40 years? Who was God grieved with for 40 years?
The Israelites.
Was it not with them that had sinned? How about that? They sinned in your life? Whose carcasses fell in the wilderness? And to whom sware he that they should not enter into his rest? But to them that believed not? Was it not those that didn't believe, didn't trust God, didn't go on with God, were not those that never entered into His rest? So we see that they could not enter in because of unbelief. So you can't acquire it on your own. Therefore, you won't get it if you're trying to do this thing on your own. Some will never acquire God's provisions. And God has the provisions. He ain't never run out. Amen. But some will never acquire it. Why? Because of sin and unbelief. They never enjoyed the fruit of the land. Those Israelites didn't. They did not get to enjoy the grape clusters that it took two men to carry. You say, you ever believe that? Yeah. Grape clusters. 6 foot, maybe, I don't know. Two men to carry it. Some of them old Israelites, they never saw it. They never got it. They never enjoyed it. Why? Because of unbelief.
Amen.
Because of something, they just didn't get it. And they never got the fact they had to repent. They had to believe God and trust God. Therefore, they didn't get it. They never enjoyed the fruit of the land. They never enjoyed the fountains of the land. What was the fountains? Well, they didn't get to enjoy the fountains of milk and honey. The Bible said there's a place of milk and honey. Fountains were flowing with milk and honey. I believe it. I wonder what fountains you've missed out on in your life because of unbelief, because of sin. You just didn't get it. God had it for you. God wanted you to have it. Why haven't you gotten it? Unbelief. Unbelief. Sin. They never enjoyed the fountains of the land. They never enjoyed the fruit of the land. They never enjoyed the fulfillment of the land. They didn't get to enjoy the fulfillment in knowing that they had finally reached the destination where God wanted them to be. I wonder what fulfillment in your life you've missed out on. Is there a boredom in your life? Is there an emptiness in your life? If there is, you just ain't got it. But you can't have it.
Amen.
Do you feel that? Do you feel like I'm just missing something? Just not getting it. Why can't I get it? Unbelief. Sin. Never repenting. Never calling on God. Never trusting God. Sometimes we have to prove ourselves to God that we're going to keep on believing regardless. I'm going to believe you whether it happens or not, whether I get fulfilled or not, whether I ever see the fruit or not, whether I ever get the fountains or not. I'm going to keep on believing. I'm going to keep on trusting. No matter how bad it gets, I'm going to keep on. You just keep proving to God that you believe in Him and He will provide. He will provide. Some will never acquire God's provision, and finally some will never acquire God's peace. They never found rest because of their unbelief, and they never found relief from the wilderness because of their unbelief. Most people are living a life without any rest. I'm not talking about physically, but in their hearts and in their minds and in their emotions, they're all jumbled up all the time. There's no rest. There's depression and worry and pressures and things coming down on them in life so hard. Are you one of those? Friend, I'm telling you, there's a place of rest.
Amen.
And peace in the Lord. Most people don't get it. Why not? Unbelief. Unrepentant. There's a place of relief for your heart and your soul, but most people just don't get it. Now, if I left it right there, and I'm closing and coming to soul, if I left it right there, I'd leave you in despair without any hope. I just said most people just don't get it. And it's a true statement. I'm not lying to you. But listen here. I want to expose a lie. There are certain preachers in the Baptist camp. There are certain people within the Baptist camp, our own denomination here. Friend, they believe that only certain people can get it. Only certain ones are set aside to get what God has for them. To get salvation. To get to go to heaven. To get all the things that God wants them to have. I've heard of one pastor at least that believes this so strongly that only certain people can get saved and only certain people get to go to heaven. He believes it so strongly that when it comes time for invitation, he doesn't give an invitation. Because he believes only certain people will get in. So why give an invitation? God's done chose them. God's done made the plan. That ain't the case. It's a lie. It's a lie. By the way, they're called ultra Calvinists. Ultra Calvinists. Stay away from that doctrine. It's false. And you say, how come you know that? Because my Bible says, whosoever will.
Amen.
Whosoever will can come. Call on the Lord. Jesus died for whosoever
Amen.
Will.
Amen.
And He died for you. He died for you. He died for you. He died for every one of us. And whosoever will can come and call on the Lord and be saved and can get right with the Lord. You don't have to be one of those old Israelites that had unbelief in their heart and sin in their life that just didn't get it. It was not God's choice they didn't get it. It was their own choice that they didn't get it. Friend, let me tell you something. You can get it. Somebody said, well, what about predestination? I believe in predestination. The Bible talks about it. You say, why? Well, how can you believe in predestination and think that everybody gets saved? Let me tell you, once you get saved, once you get, whosoever comes and gets their heart right with the Lord, anybody can do that. But once you get saved, guess what? You are predestined for heaven.
Amen.
Amen. Ain't that right?
Yes.
This is a life you can have, and you can have it if you get salvation, if you get the Savior, if you get the Spirit of God. Whosoever wants it can get it. Most people don't get it, but it's whosoever wants it can get it. It's true that most just don't get it, but it is also true that whosoever will and can have it. Don't be like most people and not get it. Come and get it. Come and get it. Let's stand this morning. Come and get it this morning. Come and get what God has for you today. If it's salvation that you need, come and get it. If it's a closer walk with the Lord, come and get it. Just come and get it. Acknowledge the past, your suffering, your sin. Acknowledge the promises. Acknowledge the power of God. Accept God's perfection, God's plan, God's presence, and then acquire God's provisions and God's peace. You can have it. Will you come get it? Come and get it. Most people won't, but you can come get it.
You've been listening to The Gospel Truth with Dr. Scott Thomas of Temple, Georgia. To order this message or to contact Brother Scott, go to www.scottthomasministries.com. That's www.scottthomasministries.com. Be sure to come back next week for more Bible preaching and The Gospel Truth.
Yes, I love my Bible.